Okay, Jackson, thank you so much for taking the time to come onto the podcast.
No worries. Thanks for having me.
Could you just give the listeners a brief overview of who you are and what it is you do at the moment?
Sure. So I'm currently a lecturer at Deakin University in Melbourne, Australia. So as part of my current role, I teach into our undergraduate exercise science program, mainly teaching into units related to exercise programming and exercise physiology. And I also undertake research in exercise science, focusing mainly on exercise prescription strategies when we're trying to improve our strength and muscle mass together with aerobic capacity or aerobic endurance. So that's my current role. And I guess prior to that, I spent my PhD years about 5 years ago looking at concurrent training specifically. So I did that at Victoria University, and we're really interested in looking at how we can try to optimize adaptation to combined or concurrent training, and particularly interested in the influence of the intensity of endurance training. So I guess both my current role and previous roles have really been focused on research in the area of concurrent training, which I'm sure we'll talk about more. But at the moment, I'm involved in teaching and research here at Deakin University.
Great. Yeah, and you've hit the nail on the head. That's the exact topic we're going to be delving into in more detail. And so I guess the first thing to touch on then is that clear definition of what that is. You know, you and I throw around this term concurrent training. So I guess it's just to clarify exactly what that means for the listeners first off.
Sure. So there's a few definitions flying around, but I guess the simplest one that I tend to come back to is it's really training where we're incorporating both resistance or strength training and some aspect of endurance or aerobic training into a training program. So basically, when our goals are to improve some measure of our endurance or aerobic capacity together with some aspect of our strength, power, or muscle mass, if we've got both of those goals in our program, we're likely going to have training aimed at those two, I guess, broad ends of the spectrum, and that's what I would consider to be concurrent training.
Great. Yeah. So basically trying to get fit and strong at the same time.
Exactly.
And that can cover a broad range of things, can't it? Like from team sports to general fitness to people who are doing, I mean, even like some Olympic athletes with different avenues that they look at. I guess it just covers such a broad remit of different sports and activities.
Definitely. So, you could argue that the majority of athletes could benefit from having aspects of endurance and some aspects of strength and power, certainly. Team sports are a really great example, but even when you look at endurance athletes, long distance endurance athletes, we know that improving strength and power can also have distinct benefits for their endurance performance as well. So even for those athletes, concurrent training is a no-brainer, and incorporating strength training in particular into their endurance training programs. And then of course there's flow-on benefits for injury prevention as well. So there's not too many athletes that wouldn't be interested in incorporating both endurance training and strength training, I don't think.
Yeah, it's interesting that you brought that up about endurance, actually, because I bet a lot of people, when they train for long endurance events, be it running or cycling, they think purely of the task at hand that they just need to cycle, they just need to run. But actually, as you said, they're incorporating some strength and power, injury prevention, and actually improving their performance in that event.
Definitely, and certainly we know that, when you're talking about the adaptations that we get from resistance training versus endurance training, they are quite distinct. And we know that one thing that strength training doesn't do is improve your aerobic capacity in terms of your VO2 max necessarily, but of course it can cause changes to our neuromuscular system that can benefit endurance training performance just by making us much more efficient. And a lot of the thinking is around that strength training can really improve that neuromuscular efficiency, and that's how that can benefit endurance training performance.
Yeah, that's interesting. So you're looking beyond those sort of adaptations on the muscular level, more towards a neuromuscular level, which is super interesting. And I mean, talking about that then, because I guess when it comes to training strength, training endurance, it's all this talk about the interference effect, right? And this is one thing that we still seem to be not immediately sure on what's causing it, but we know it's there. So I guess it's to talk to listeners a little bit about, I guess, what the interference effect is, first of all, and why it potentially is there.
Sure. So I guess, you know, while both resistance training and endurance training clearly have distinct benefits for health and performance, what we tend to see is that when we're trying to incorporate both of these into the same training program, the adaptations that we get from the strength training component seem to be slightly less when we're also doing endurance training than if we were just doing the strength training alone. So that's what this classic interference effect is. It's essentially a blunting of classic resistance training adaptations, primarily strength and power. There is a little bit of evidence potentially that muscle growth might be also impaired as well, but essentially it's a blunting of these resistance training related adaptations when we're trying to incorporate both endurance and resistance training into the same program. So that's essentially what that is. So there's been quite a lot of work trying to understand the different factors that influence this. And there's different studies that show that strength and power might be affected, but muscle hypertrophy or muscle growth isn't affected. So it's clearly a complex area, and we're trying to tease out what the different mechanisms and factors are at play at the moment.
But it's one of those where it's going to be there. Right, and I guess what we need to do then is try to mitigate that as best we can, as opposed to try to eradicate it completely.
Exactly. So I guess when you're trying to incorporate two different types of training into your program, there's so many different factors that can be manipulated in order to change the training outcome. So we're really trying to understand, and a lot of my PhD work kind of kicked this off in terms of looking at endurance training intensity in particular, but trying to understand what the role of different training variables are in promoting or reducing this interference effect, so that we can hopefully come up with practical strategies to try and maximize the best of both worlds, if you like. And I think if we can try and break that down a little bit, we can come up with some clear guidelines to help people incorporate both training modes into their program and try and get the best benefits out of both.
Well, then let's dive into that first of all, because as you said, there's if we talk training first of all, and then we can dive into nutrition a little bit later. In terms of training, let's go with organization first off. If we're looking to maximize adaptations in both a VO2 max capacity, endurance capacity, as well as a strength and power capacity, how might we organize training sessions best as possible in order to achieve that?
Yeah, so I guess the first thing to consider is that when we're trying to incorporate both of these training modes into a program, we can take one approach where we try and do them both in the same session. Where we might come in and do our strength session followed by our endurance training session, or vice versa, or we might try and do them in separate sessions.
Okay.
So I guess that there's two different approaches there in terms of how we might organize our training. And one of the, I guess, what a lot of the evidence is starting to show is we think that separating out the sessions as much as possible is probably best from minimizing the interference effect from the perspective of that. But if you are to do them within the same session, and if you are wanting to minimize any interference to your strength training adaptations, it's likely better to begin that session with your strength training and then perform your endurance training after that. And a lot of this comes down to a bit of an understanding of the mechanisms at play here. So if we are getting an interference effect, what's causing it? And to a large degree, a lot of that is a bit unclear, but what we are starting to lean towards now is the fact that it's really a residual carryover fatigue effect from endurance training that's influencing how we perform in strength training, and therefore influencing how we adapt to strength training. So those two strategies I just mentioned, either doing your strength training first in the same session or trying to separate out the two sessions as much as you can, is really aimed at trying to minimize any leftover fatigue that you have before you start your strength training, so that you can maximize the loads and intensities that you're working at, which hopefully maximizes the adaptation that you get from a strength and power perspective in particular, but potentially from a muscle growth perspective as well. So I guess that's one or a couple of different strategies there. The others are more specific to the actual training sessions themselves, so the content of each session. So if we consider that it's mainly a case that the endurance training is influencing our strength training, a lot of the work we try to focus on is how do we manipulate the endurance training component in order to have less of an influence on the strength training. So I was really interested in endurance training intensity. So with the popularity of high intensity interval training and, you know, obviously that's quite commonly performed in athletes. So we were interested in whether or not that plays a role in influencing how we adapt to concurrent training. And certainly the higher the intensity of the endurance training, you'd assume that there would be more fatigue following that session, and that might have more of a negative influence on strength training. So that's another key aspect that we've looked at. Mm-hmm. The other factor is that, of course, endurance training can be performed in a variety of different modes. So you can have cycling, you can have running, you can have a combination of different modes there, and they likely have different levels of fatigue associated with them as well. Mm-hmm. So you can see that this is clearly a complex area, but a lot of the strategies that we tend to kind of recommend tend to be based around this idea of this residual fatigue from endurance training and trying to think about how we change the actual training we're doing and the structure of it during the week in order to minimize the effect of that fatigue on strength training.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I'm doubling back to that point. It was nice how you said, right, well, we would recommend separating them out as separate sessions. But if you're a time-constrained individual and you can only do one session, then order it with strength first, followed then by the endurance component, because you want to maximize the adaptations from the strength and power, and the endurance side of things will take care of themselves. With regards to the splitting sessions, if we do double back to that, and then we can talk about the intensity of the endurance piece, because that is definitely very interesting. In terms of the two sessions, is there a best case scenario in case of doing endurance then first thing in the morning and doing strength training later in the afternoon or evening after you've had X amount of time to recover and refuel? Or is it strength training first and endurance last, or does that not matter as much?
I guess ideally, and I mean, a lot of people are commonly doing their training, you know, it might not be on separate days, it might be sort of in morning afternoon splits, as you mentioned. Mm-hmm. I think if we're primarily looking at this from an optimizing strength training adaptation perspective and minimizing that classic interference effect, which sort of brings back to another point, it really depends on what the priorities are in the program. But mm-hmm. I think if we're primarily interested in the strength training adaptation and minimizing any negative effect on that, I think whether we're doing the two training sessions, so strength training and endurance training, whether we're doing that in the same session or morning, afternoon splits, if you like, I think for the most part, it'd be better to get your strength training done first when you're most fresh, if you like, from a neuromuscular perspective. Mm-hmm. So the performance in that session is maximized. Of course, it depends what you've done the day before as well, and kind of what carryover fatigue you might have from that. So you can see how it gets quite complex. But I think as a general, I think doing strength training before endurance training is a good thing if we're wanting to minimize any negative influence on that strength training adaptation.
Cool. Yeah. And as you said, it depends on like everything you've done the day before. And then that's where like longer term periodization comes in. And I mean, you talk then about the goal of the athlete at that period of time as well. So, I mean, that's where it can come down to having different blocks of different focuses. Like if your endurance potential is actually just at a maintenance level for that block and you're focusing more on a strength adaptation, then yeah, prioritize that. You're having that at a higher volume, and you know, that's, you've got to consider all those things first, I guess, before you then order things.
Yeah, definitely. And I guess, you know, I've often looked at this through the lens of, you know, the endurance training influencing how we adapt to strength training. But of course, for endurance athletes, they're mainly interested in concurrent training for the perspective of improving endurance performance. So, you know, there's also evidence that doing strength training can also acutely and negatively influence performance during endurance training sessions as well.
Right.
So if you're an endurance athlete and you've got a key, you know, training session that you're doing for that week, in particular, any strength training you do before that could also influence how you perform in that key endurance training session. So that's not something that you would want to compromise if you are an endurance athlete.
Mm-hmm.
So again, you need to kind of look at this from both sides, even though, you know, a lot of the evidence suggests that it's really the strength training adaptation that could be influenced. Of course, as an endurance athlete, you don't want to be compromising your key endurance training sessions. So that's something to consider as well.
Yeah, no, I'm glad you brought that up because, as you said there, like quite a lot of the research does have these different graphs where they're like in the endurance with concurrent training, it was matched with the endurance of endurance only, but it was the strength that took more of the hit. But
yep.
If there is some evidence there with, especially if you had like a really big strength and power session in the week of a bigger endurance event or session, it's going to have an effect. So it's thinking about your volume of each element of training within a week, within a cycle, depending on the goal of training.
Definitely.
And so talking about when you were discussing the kind of order of sessions, you were then talking about the intensity of the endurance piece. And I think this is quite key because there is a lot more fashion, if you'd like, around like high intensity interval training. And a lot of people do it because they see other people doing it. It's fast, it's fun, it's sexy. And they think that's going to get them sort of a bigger rate of return of their results. So what have you found in terms of the intensity of endurance exercise and this interference effect?
Sure. So you're dead right there that you know, there's an increasing popularity of high intensity interval training for a variety of reasons, and not just for athletes. It's you know, much more popular now in the general population. And I guess from the perspective of concurrent training, if we consider that the higher the intensity of endurance training, likely the greater degree of neuromuscular fatigue that might be caused by that session, so that our ability to produce force and power might be compromised for a certain period of time. You would think that potentially if we're doing a lot of high intensity endurance training around our strength training sessions, that's going to be suboptimal from a sort of an interference effect perspective. So that was exactly the question that my PhD work sought to answer. So we had young, recreationally active males perform a study where they did 8 weeks of periodized strength training that was aimed primarily at improving their strength. And we had two other groups do the same program, but they combined that with either a high intensity interval training cycling session or a work and duration matched continuous training, to lower intensity fixed intensity continuous training session that was cycling as well. And we actually had them do that session before their strength training sessions as well, which is interesting based on what I just said. But the idea was that it would try and tell us whether or not the intensity of the endurance training was important in seeing how those people adapted to the concurrent training program. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of limitations with, you know, with any research study. There's always things that can be manipulated differently. But what we found was that actually the degree of interference to strength and power adaptation in particular was actually the same.
Right.
Virtually the same with both of those protocol, so comparing the high intensity interval training to the lower intensity continuous training program, we virtually saw the same decrement in strength gain. So they gained about, I think it was about 25% less strength than those that just did the strength training only. So that didn't really, I guess, prove our hypothesis. We were thinking that the high intensity interval training might influence the strength training adaptation more than the other continuous training program. We think there's a lot of reasons why perhaps it didn't. Perhaps the fact that it was cycling meant that the amount of fatigue that was occurring may have been a lot less than if we had have used running, for example. We didn't use the intensity was high. We used sort of a 2 minutes on, 1 minute off protocol. But the intensity of those sort of protocols aren't anything close to what you might get during a sprint interval training, like a 30-second all-out type. So maybe the intensity wasn't quite high enough to see an interference effect there. We're not sure. But so that was our study. We didn't really see an intensity effect in our study. But we still think that that there might be one there based on some of the things that we didn't incorporate into our study. And looking at a few other I guess acute or short-term studies, there's certainly evidence that the higher the intensity of endurance training, the more of a fatiguing effect that has, and more that reduces our ability to produce force for, you know, at least sort of 6 hours post-exercise. So there's certainly that evidence that could be indirectly, I guess, extrapolated across to suggest, well, perhaps that might be not a great thing for strength training if we're incorporating that as well. But in our hands, in that particular study, we didn't see an intensity effect, but we're doing a lot more now to understand the actual factors that influence the degree of fatigue that's caused by high intensity interval training in particular. And then we've got follow-up work to plan to actually see whether or not that degree of fatigue tells us how people are going to adapt to the concurrent training program.
Right. Okay. Yeah. So almost in like an individual case by case basis, how they might adapt.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. You know, we certainly do think that this fatigue element is important. And if we consider that a lot of athletes are going to be incorporating high intensity interval training, and a lot of recreational people like to do it as well, it's kind of how do we calibrate and manipulate that high intensity interval training session to adjust the degree of fatigue that it causes? Because we know from the work of sort of Martin Bechet and Paul Larson with their HIIT science work, that you can have two different HIIT sessions that give us the same aerobic stimulus, aerobic benefits, but there might be differing degrees of neuromuscular fatigue caused by those sessions. So for concurrent training, we might be really interested to know, how do we adjust that session to tone down the neuromuscular fatigue, keep the same aerobic benefits so that it has less of an influence on our strength training later in the day or later that session.
Yeah, but you still get a great aerobic benefit, as you said there.
Yeah.
Interesting, as you said, because it could have just been the fact that it was cycling. It would be interesting to compare that to running and rowing and all the other different like endurance modalities you have. I mean, as you said, that's the limitation in research. You wish that you could test everything at once or like have multiple like experiments all going on. The protocol, interesting as well, you know, 2 minutes on, 1 minute off. It would be interesting to experiment with, like, as you said, like a very high intense sprint and then giving them very, very high rest periods. So, you know, like a 30 second sprint with a 3.5 minute rest or something, so the intensity is super, super high.
Because it's those sort of protocols. We're thinking those sort of protocols are the ones that are going to cause the most neuromuscular fatigue. So that's exactly what we're looking at the moment. It's, you know, it's likely that those are going to influence how we're performing in our strength training later in the day. But we can still have high intensity interval training that is much less of an intense intensity than those sort of sessions.
Yeah. And then it's figuring out just exactly how that looks, or as close to as possible, so that you can then organize training sessions as effectively as possible with these sort of divergent goals.
Of course.
And I guess that's just a key point. Again, if we revert back to that idea of it depends on the goal of the, not just the session, but the training block, you would think concurrent athletes, they're going to have to be thinking longer term periodization, because if they're peaking for a competition X months down the line, they might have a strength and power block with more like aerobic endurance sort of on the back burner. And then if they need a high level of high intense endurance, you know, pent up for that competition, it's a case of building that up gradually throughout the block and then bringing strength down to maybe maintenance rather than pushing it, and, you know, just being cleverer with it in a whole.
Exactly, because there might be ways that we can kind of minimize this interference effect, but as you've said earlier, we're likely not to get rid of it completely. So it's about being smart with our training so that we understand what the priorities are each given time, each block of training, and then just manipulating our training accordingly. So we might be focusing slightly on one more end of the spectrum than the other, but that's adjusted over time in line with our long-term goals.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, it's super interesting. And I guess then from a nutritional perspective, there are certain schools of thought, I guess, around timing different potentially macronutrients for different goals of the session. I remember I was reading... there was a lecture actually that Lee did for the Mac Nutrition Organization, where he talked about concurrent training, Lee Hamilton, and discussed about, you know, doing endurance training in the morning, potentially fasted, and then refueling throughout the day, more protein and carbohydrates for a strength training in the afternoon. And then think, you know, he said, depending on the intensity of that endurance session in the morning, you could have carbs at night or not, depending on kind of what you wanted to the adaptation you were looking to stimulate. So I guess from your experience in terms of different things that you've tried with, again, maximizing adaptations, minimizing the interference effect, what have you found as almost sort of best practices?
Yeah, so I guess the nutrition element isn't my area of expertise specifically, but in terms of what I do know about some of the recommendations that have been given in this area, I guess from an endurance training perspective and optimizing adaptation to endurance training, it's interesting that there's been a lot of work done to suggest that if we're actually lowering energy availability, in particular carbohydrate availability around that session, we might really ramp up the signal in the muscle to improve endurance or aerobic capacity. Whereas that strategy in terms of restricting nutrients doesn't seem to make a lot of sense around strength training adaptation. Mm-hmm. So as you mentioned, there might be some opportunities there that if we're conducting an endurance training session in the morning and we're doing that, you know, potentially some sessions with low carbohydrate availability to try and ramp up that endurance signal. Clearly, it's going to be important what we do then between that session and our subsequent strength training session to try and refuel, maximize rates of muscle protein synthesis, etc. So getting in protein, refueling with carbohydrate to refuel muscle glycogen stores that are, you know, likely going to be important to power that subsequent strength training session, etc. So certainly, you know, that's one consideration is what we actually do from a nutritional standpoint in between these two different modes of training. And then, of course, after our strength training, the nutrition is, you know, very much focused around trying to ramp up the signals for muscle growth and strength in particular. Mm. So I guess from that perspective, nutrition is likely very important. Something that's been coming out of the literature a lot lately that's kind of changed my thinking around this is the idea that in terms of strength training, obviously we've got our, you know, primary adaptations being strength, power, and muscle growth. When we're looking at which of those adaptations are most affected by concurrent training, it seems to be the strength and power that is most commonly seen to be affected negatively by doing the endurance training in that concurrent training program. Mm. There's actually only a couple of studies that have shown that muscle growth is blunted with a concurrent training program. And in the studies that we've done, we actually haven't really seen that much ourselves either, whether that's because there isn't an interference effect there, but it's quite small that we can't really pick it up. I'm not sure. But I think that's important to understand that the magnitude of interference you get to strength and power is much greater than what you would see to muscle growth. Mm. So the question is then from a nutritional standpoint, a lot of nutritional guidelines, I guess, are mainly geared around, promoting muscle growth, I guess, and I guess indirectly strength through muscle growth. There's a lot of stuff coming out now really that's trying to question the role of muscle growth in strength, and we don't necessarily have to go down that rabbit hole, but so it's a complex area, but certainly nutrition is really, really important. We want to be trying to use our nutrition to maximize our recovery, maximize our performance, and how we adapt to those training sessions. But exactly how we go about that, I don't think we have really an optimal strategy at this point.
No, I think, everyone's looking for the optimal thing and the magic bullet, isn't it? But it's a case of you've actually probably got to think about overall energy availability. What do you need in a day based on the volume that you're doing? And thinking like, okay, if I'm doing X amount of hours of training and I want to get the most out of it, energy balance is going to be what I want to achieve. What does that look like? And then just timing it sort of when you can eat around your sessions to in order to feel good for those sessions, and that'll look different depending on the person. It was interesting actually, you said like, let's not go down the rabbit hole, but the whole like strength and hypertrophy thing is quite interesting because there is that idea of, well, yeah, bigger muscles are stronger muscles, but then you've got weightlifters in the sub 70 kilo category lifting three times their body weight, and you think, well, okay, they don't have to be big to be super, super strong either. There's definitely a separate adaptation there. And whether that's due to muscle type fibers or neuromuscular efficiency or a combination of both, I think that's still yet to be, well, I guess, that's what it is. And then it's just looking at that further down the line.
Yeah, of course. So I guess from the perspective of factors that influence our strength and our power, you know, there's neural factors, so our nervous system and how that's actually activating our muscle fibers, and then there's actually the size of our muscle fibers and our muscle mass that can also influence how much force we can produce. So it's the engine is our muscles, if you like. The bigger the engine, the thought is that the more force and power we can produce, and then there's actually what's driving the engine, which is our nervous system, and the more fine-tuned that is, the more we can actually get out of our muscle mass as well. So clearly, you know, it's likely that both of those factors contribute to strength and power gains with resistance training, but the relative contribution of those two things is something that's being debated pretty heavily at the moment. And you know, those that sit on the side that say that, well, muscle growth isn't, you know, it might be playing a contributory role, but it's not the main driver of strength gain, they'll, you know, cite studies that show that we can improve our strength and our power without changes in our muscle mass. And the flip side of that is that when people go through a period of strength training and they get improvements in strength, power and muscle mass, and then they detrain for a period, so they stop training, their muscle mass will reduce, but often there's a maintenance of strength and power, again showing that all of those strength and power gains and losses aren't completely explained by what's going on with muscle mass. Yeah, so it's a complex area.
It's interesting. Like, there's almost like a longer lag time between, like, a longer detraining effect for strength, but not hypertrophy, which is really interesting. And based on what you were talking about before with concurrent research, how you've not personally found in your own research that hypertrophy, which is the muscle growth, has been affected, but more the muscle strength has been affected. It's like the endurance adaptation is almost having an effect, as you said, on a neuromuscular efficiency level and a neural drive level, not necessarily on the signaling to get the muscles bigger. So,
yeah, exactly. You've actually hit the nail on the head there, because I guess this is where my thinking is shifting slightly in this area over time. Since I did my PhD, I mean, a lot of the other stuff we did during my PhD was also looking at what's going on inside the muscles of the individuals who are doing these training programs to see whether or not we could detect at a cellular level, at a molecular level, what's going on in terms of the signals for muscle growth and whether those signals are being turned down by the endurance training and whether that might explain how we get blunted adaptation. But a lot of that thinking relies on the notion that we're going to get a blunting of muscle growth. And then I guess indirectly, if we're thinking that muscle growth is influencing strength, then yes, that could explain strength adaptation as well. But I am starting to look at this more from the lens of this fatigue effect, in that if we're getting less drive to the muscle, that's going to influence how we can perform during strength training and then influence our strength gains. But I'm not sure as to how much of an influence that will have on our muscle growth. And as I said, that the evidence is relatively weak for muscle growth being impaired with concurrent training compared to strength and power.
Yeah, interesting. So it's like, if you want to be bigger, then, you know, you can do endurance training alongside it. But in terms of actual strength improvements, then it's being a little bit cleverer with your endurance side of things. And as you said, the research is ongoing in terms of the exact modality of that, whether cycling and rowing would be better than running because there's less of a less of that concentric action, less muscle work being done. I guess, like, you know, if you're cycling, even just cycling on an exercise bike, there's some resistance going there. Even on the road, you know, depending on hills and things like that, like, you're using your legs quite heavily. It's not as damaging as running, but there's still that sort of like building of muscle being done because of the work against resistance.
Yeah, definitely. So we can kind of look at that from two perspectives, I guess. Yeah, it's likely that running is, with those eccentric actions, is causing more muscle damage, more neuromuscular fatigue than cycling. There is some evidence that we can get some degree of muscle growth from cycling, but there's less evidence of that occurring from running. So whether that's having an influence as well, I'm not sure. But certainly the endurance training modality is going to be important in this interference effect. And given that most team sport athletes, for example, are going to be using running, a lot of the work we're doing now is really focusing on how do we manipulate running-based HIIT in particular to try and see whether we can influence the degree of neuromuscular fatigue that's caused.
Yeah, yeah, because as you said, it's going to be based on the function of the person and the athlete. As you know, if we're talking to just people who are general population and they're just looking to look good and train well and but also have a good VO2 max, it's like cycling and rowing are probably going to be better for you based on what we know alongside your strength and work. But if you're playing rugby or doing CrossFit or something like that, it's like, well, you've kind of got to run. So we need to know how to plan that without affecting strength and power as much.
Yeah, and that's another important point as well is, again, it comes down to your goals. If you're not an elite athlete and you're just looking to get some benefits from your training in terms of aerobic fitness and a bit of strength, a bit of muscle growth, then, you know, we know that incorporating both of these, however you do it, you're going to get some benefit. And we're talking like, you know, the small percentages here in terms of trying to optimize it. But, you know, often we can get too bogged down in trying to get everything to what we think might be optimal. But, you know, sometimes optimal can be the enemy of action as well. So, you know, just getting in there and doing something. If you're not at that elite end of the spectrum, you maybe don't have to be too concerned with that.
Yeah.
And again, that's probably another way my thinking has shifted a little bit, that, you know, it's super clear to understand that doing all these things is going to have some sort of benefit. In some circumstances might not have as much benefit as it could if we structured our training a little bit differently, but we're still going to get some sort of benefit. And I think that's an important point to remember.
Yeah. Like don't look at everything as we've said and try to tease out as optimally as you can. If it's not going to be likely for you to be able to stick to it, or it's going to make everything an absolute nightmare, because as you said, action is better than inaction.
Yeah.
So it's about being consistent with what you can do. We're just talking about it from, I guess, a geeky, optimize it, try it.
Yeah.
But it's interesting. It's very interesting. I guess the last question I would have would be, we talked about intensity of endurance. And I guess my question would be around volume of endurance training within sessions, within weeks, because I guess there's definitely some research around like the longer you then do endurance work for, there's sort of more of an interference effect. And I don't know if that's what you found or that's still what's commonly held to be believed.
Yeah, so definitely volume will likely play a role in the interference effect. There is some evidence from a meta-analysis of various different concurrent training studies that basically combine the results of various studies done up until that point. That was published in 2012. That seemed to show that with higher weekly durations of endurance training and high frequencies of endurance training, there tend to be more of an interference effect. That's, I guess, one line of evidence that the greater the volume of endurance training, the worse that is from a strength training adaptation standpoint. There's a couple of studies that have looked at different ratios of endurance training to strength training, showing that the more endurance training you did relative to your strength training, that that was worse for strength training outcomes. So again, from that perspective, it seems that volume might be somewhat important, which is also interesting when you consider that high intensity interval training is posited as a high intensity yet low volume approach. So, you know, is it the intensity? Is it the volume? The interesting thing about the study I was talking about before, about my PhD study, we compared high intensity interval training with traditional lower intensity continuous training, but we equated the volume of those two programs. So the volume was exactly the same. It was just one group did it in kind of a 2 minute on, 1 minute off HIIT type format. The others just did it in a continuous format. But the actual amount of work or volume that was completed by those groups in terms of endurance training was the same.
Yeah.
So we couldn't be sure whether, you know, we were just seeing a volume effect in that we saw the same blunting of strength because the volume was the same. But again, the intensities that we were using were not quite as high as what we might see in like a sprint interval training type scenario, where we might be doing 30 seconds as hard as we can and then having really extended rest periods. So, so certainly I think, you know, both volume and intensity have the potential to cause this interference effect or worsen this interference effect. So potentially if we're reducing both, we might have better strength training outcomes, but then we probably have suboptimal endurance training outcomes as well. So
you've got to do some of it, you know.
That's right. So that's when it kind of, you know, it comes down to where we structure those sessions during the week and whether we can still get away with very high intensity sessions, so long as we allow enough recovery between sessions and our, you know, nutrition between interval type sessions and strength sessions is good as well. Mm-hmm. We might still be able to get away with minimizing that interference effect as well.
Yeah. And I guess, you know, I said about volume being last question, but it's just interesting what you came up there in terms of separating sessions on different days is obviously what you talked about at the very, very early on in the podcast. But, you know, there are a school of people who will train every day if they could. And there could be some people listening to this being like, okay, well, if I lift, you know, 3 to 4 times a week and then do endurance 3 to 4 times a week, I can make that work 7 days a week and just train every day. For like an hour to an hour and a half. And I don't know if you've seen any research in that kind of method being used and whether there's, you know, because their day of doing endurance is basically rest from weights, so it's not rest completely from training and then vice versa. But whether it be, say, like, no, you still probably only want to train sort of 5 to 6 times a week max, depending on your training age, or whether that's just something that's not been looked at yet.
Yeah, I mean, there has been a few studies that have looked at very high volume training programs, both from an endurance perspective and a strength training perspective, done together in the same mm-hmm. concurrent training program. If you go back to the original study that first showed that concurrent training could blunt strength gains, that was a study from Hickson in 1980. He used a very high volume, high intensity program. I think they were doing something like 5 sessions a week of low body strength training on top of 5 sessions, 4 or 5 sessions a week, I think it was, of endurance sessions.
Right, yeah, well.
That included running, cycling, a mix of intensities as well. And that study was really interesting because they actually tested the strength of participants every week during a 10-week training program. Mm-hmm. So you actually saw the time course for strength improvements, which improved for all groups up until about, I think, 7 weeks of training. And then what you saw after that point was that the concurrent training groups then dropped off in terms of their strength, so that the strength group kept improving, the concurrent group then stopped improving. And look, some people have argued whether that's just an overtraining type effect that, mm-hmm. You know, because not only did the concurrent training group not improve as much as the strength training group after week 7, but they actually started dropping off. So right, they started getting worse. Mm-hmm. So, and you don't see that in a lot of studies because often you don't test strength every week. You might just test strength at the start, middle, and end, or just at the start and the end. So you don't actually see the actual what's happening over time necessarily. Mm-hmm. So a couple of studies have looked at that really high volume approach from both an endurance and a strength perspective, and clearly that's not going to be great from a strength training standpoint in particular. Mm-hmm. But whether that reflects sort of real world scenarios, I'm sure there are people out there that do those sort of volumes of training. But I think if you are looking to do those volumes of training, certainly using a periodized approach where you're not doing those volumes of work for both endurance and strength training in the same week all the time, you might be prioritizing one versus the other and then switching around. I think that's a much more sensible approach in the long term.
Yeah, it's good that you mentioned that, because there definitely will be people listening to this podcast and people that I know who will probably do 5 sessions of each per week and actually at high intensities, high volumes, and kind of probably, you know, still sort of just maintaining where they're at by the skin of their teeth. And so it's interesting how you mentioned, you know, these people actually did drop off because they tested where they were at. And so it's definitely the overtraining effect is a real thing. So if you feel like you're not kind of going forward or you are slightly going backwards, it's a case of potentially overtraining, under recovering, and a combination of both if you are trying to maximize both. Great. Well, Jackson, this has been a great conversation. You know, your name brings up a lot of articles in PubMed, but are there any sort of other places where people can find more about you and more of your work?
Yeah, I guess I try to be relatively active on Twitter. So my handle is @JacksonFife. So try to share interesting papers and insights on there. So happy to connect with people on there, and more than happy for you to share my email address as well if people want to get in touch with me that way. But probably Twitter's the main go-to for connecting with me.
Cool. So everyone go and troll Jackson on Twitter. So thanks again for coming on. I really appreciate your time.
No, thanks for having me.